Messy CSVs, weird headers, numbers changing after refresh? Not today. We'll get your data into clean and repeatable steps that are auditable and refresh safe. This is the do it once, trust it forever part of Power Query. No VBA, no manual fixes, just steps you can replay on every refresh. And I'll show you where Microsoft Fabric steps it up. Folding indicators and the new query plan that explain exactly what runs where. A chef's kiss for troubleshooting. Grab the sample files in the QR code on the screen if you want to try some of these things and build with me. Clean it right once and everything downstream gets easier. Enough of all this talking. You know we like to do it here on Guy in a Cube. Let's do what? Let's head over to my machine. Power Query is the ETL or extract, transform, and load engine behind Power BI and Dataflows with inside of Microsoft Fabric. It gives you a visual editor to build a repeatable refresh process. Let's take a quick look of what's in here. I'm already opened a file that I already have just to illustrate this, and then we'll start over from scratch. So first off, we've got our ribbons up top. We can do transform actions. We can add columns. We can view various things. We've also got some other tools here from a diagnostic perspective. And of course, help that you may need, except for this video, I am the help. So ignore that tab. The other thing you'll know as part of Power Queries, there's tons of options inside of it. So explore it, go right click on things and see what you find. So if I right click on a table, you'll see a bunch of actions. If I do it on a column, you'll see a bunch of actions. If I do it on a cell, you'll see a bunch of actions. If I do it on one of the steps over here, you'll see a bunch of actions. And then overall, you can probably do 80 to 90% of all of the operations just from the UI. And there is an option if you want to go further deep down. We're not going to really get into it in this video, but if you go to this advanced editor on the ribbon bar, you can actually see the M script. So M is the language of Power Query, and you can customize this. You can do advanced actions, and you can get there again from right-clicking on things and go to advanced editor. So the thing I really want to call out here is this applied steps area. So after every action you do inside of Power Query, a line will be created in here. Each line in here corresponds to that advanced M script. So each line in here is one of the steps here. So if you make a change here, it goes over here and vice versa. And so just know that you can go back if you're trying to troubleshoot things, we can come back and say, hey, what did this look like on this step? And boom, you can see what that looks like. And then we can go back to the end step and go play around and then figure out, do I need to move things around? You can drag and drop these if they need to go in a different order. Also notice this gear icon. So like for source, if I go ahead and click the gear icon, it'll actually ask me where I want to get that data from. Pretty helpful. You can update the source right from the UI. That was just a quick overview of the UI of Power Query. Now let's actually start over inside of a fresh Power BI desktop file, and we're going to go get some data. Once I'm inside of Power BI desktop with nothing here, I need to go get some data. And so I'm going to go up to get data, and you can go grab one of these other sources. Microsoft is so very helpful to you. Obviously, they're just giving you the sources that you're probably just using anyway, and they're just right here on the list. In this case, though, you also have options for more, and there are a ton of connectors inside of Power Query. If you don't see your connector, you can use this ODBC source, and likely your data source has an ODBC driver that's available for it. So if you have that installed, then you can just use ODBC, even though there's not a native connector. In this case, let's go to Azure. I'm going to go Azure SQL Database. You could just go regular SQL Server, and that's fine too. But I want to do this because I want to highlight something in here known as query folding. So I put in my server name and my database name. You'll also see this connection mode of import versus direct query. This video is not really diving into the differences between import and direct query. We've got other videos on that on the Guy in a Cube channel. There's also some great documentation on it. Just know import means that I'm making a copy of the data, pulling that into Power BI Desktop. Direct query itself means that I'm actually issuing queries directly to the data source at the time. So I've got schema inside of Power BI, but the data resides in the data source. For this video, we're just going to stick with import. Also, under advanced options, you can do various things here. You can adjust command timeout. You can issue your own SQL statement. Number one rule, don't break the fold. And this could break the fold by default. So use caution if you're doing that. All right, I'm going to leave everything standard. Let's hit OK. And then we get our listing of tables with inside of the database. I'm just going to go grab a few here. So let me grab customer. You're going to be enticed to hit this green button that says load because it's front and center. Don't do that. Hit transform data. You'll thank me later. And when we do that, it will bring up the Power Query editor. And here is now where I can start doing things. Before we actually clean some things up, I want to grab one more piece of data here. I'm going to go to new source. In this case, I'm going to say text CSV, and I'm going to go in here and grab subcategory CSV. Check the QR code if you want to grab this. This one, I'll just hit OK. And so now we've got all of this data here present. So now I'm grabbing some data from SQL Server, and I'm also bringing in some data from CSV, which is really nice about Power Query because I can bring in various sources of data and have one view of this that will go into my semantic model inside of Power BI. The end user doesn't need to know about any of that. You're stitching this together from a Power Query perspective, which is incredibly powerful. Maybe that's where they put the word power in front of Power BI and Power Query. So a couple cleanup things I'm going to do here. I'm going to get rid of this PBI underscore. So the big thing to keep in mind here is we want these items to be usable and readable by the end user. Once you've cleaned up your table names, I want to do the same thing for my column names as well. Again, we want to keep this usable for customers. So like, for example, here I can just double click on order date and I can put a space in there. And you'll see that it's adding an applied step here for renaming columns. We scroll over, we can do this for a few others. So those are all the big things that we want. Another thing you can do here, if we come over, you'll see this sales order number. This is a string column. From a Power BI perspective, strings are harder to work with. Power BI likes star schemas, fact table in the middle, dimensions around the end. Strings on the dimension are okay. Strings on the fact table is not ideal. And typically you want to see, do you actually need it? If not, get rid of it. We can see here the sales order number, it's a string. Am I gonna use this in my report? Am I gonna use it in my data? For my purposes, probably not. So one thing we can do here is let's go ahead and get rid of this column. It's as easy as just coming up here to choose columns. And when I come here, I can just uncheck sales order number and hit okay, and boom, it's gone. And then you see that step there, remove other columns. If you feel like you made a mistake or you want to change it, just hit this gear icon and you can change the columns that are there. It's also like this fusion key. I probably don't need that either. So let's get rid of that one too. All right. So now let's go to customers. And here we'll just do something cool here. First name, middle name, last name. I can come up to add column. We can say from examples, and I can say, let's do full name. I'm just going to give it a column name. And then here, I always like to start with someone that has a middle initial, and we can just type in free text. When I hit enter, you'll see it just grabbed everything. And you'll see there's some extra spaces here for the folks that have null for their middle name. That's okay. Let's go ahead and hit okay. Now we've got this column. I'm going to come up and right click on full name, and we're going to say replace values. And so I'm going to tap my spacebar twice because there's two spaces inside of there. It's the space on either side of the null. And so I'm going to do space, space, and then we're going to replace that with just one space. And so we'll just do a single space and hit okay. And now you'll see, hopefully you could tell there that it shrunk a little bit. And again, every time we do an action, it's got this applied step in front of this. When we're using a relational database, so not like an Excel file or CSV, but in this case, SQL Server, what it's actually doing is what's called query folding. I call it query squishing. So it takes all of those steps, puts them into one statement that goes against your database instead of going back and forth. So if you break the fold, you're likely gonna suffer performance problems. And this also goes back to the data transformation maxim that Matthew Roach came up with, where data transformation should be performed as far upstream as possible and as far downstream as necessary. This is why I like query folding, is it pushes that back to the database. Obviously, if you can do things in a view over on the database, you wanna do that first. Now, one thing we've got here, we've got this subcategory that's here. If we go back to the advanced editor, you can see that there is a file path here. So one thing, I'll just show you this real quick, is we can actually go in and create a parameter and go to manage parameters, do new parameter, CSV path, we'll say type is text, and then current value we'll say is this path. So there is our actual file path, and then we can change this. You can easily change where it is. So now, I can come back in and I'm just gonna manually change this to CSV path. So there's my variable, we hit done, and that should work. And boom, all the data is still there, but it's using this. So now I can just change the parameter and update it if the file path changes, or if you have a difference between what you're doing locally with Power BI Desktop and then when you publish this to the service, maybe you've got it on a broader network share or someplace that's accessible for gateways. So this helps you adjust this as you're moving from dev to test to production. And these parameters are editable from the service. So now we've got our data here. Actually, for data types, let me go back. Order date. Let's just change that to a date. We'll change this to a date also. If you don't need time, don't use it. Because again, that hurts compression from a semantic model perspective. So we'll just say date for all of those. Once you hit close and load, what it's actually going to do is pull that data into the semantic model. Inside of the Power Query Editor, you're working with preview data. So it's not actually in Power BI Desktop yet or in that semantic model. And, you know, we can do some cool things here. Let's just grab sales amount. It's quick and dirty. I haven't modeled my data or anything. And then if we do product color, boom, I can use the data because I hit close and load. And you'll notice all of the names. They look kind of good, right? If I hit refresh, it's actually going to go back out to the sources and reload that data inside of my semantic model. One thing to be aware of is when you do that refresh, you may see those numbers change. And that's because before you hit refresh, it was working with that cached version of the data because I imported the data. And then when I refresh it, it's going back out to those sources to pull in the latest data. All right, let's look at Power Query versus Dataflows Gen 2. That's part of Microsoft Fabric. Although everything's part of Microsoft Fabric, but two big things I want to show you here. One is that we talked about query folding, not breaking the fold. I can't tell that from this applied steps. You do have this view native query, which will show you the SQL query that's going back. If you do see this, it does mean that we're folding, which is good. If you don't see it, that doesn't mean that you're not folding. It could be grayed out, but you're still folding. So don't rely on that. So the one thing I want to do here is let's just go to advanced editor. I'm just going to copy and paste this. And then let's go over to the service. And I'm just going to create a new Dataflows Gen 2. Now, normally inside of Dataflows, you can do everything you just did. We can go to get data. We can pull data in, all of those great things. But in this scenario, all I want to do is validate is my query folding. So let's go ahead and go to get data. I'm going to do blank query. And then what we're going to do is say, let's go and get the source. And so I'm just copy and pasting, and then we'll do next. And let's see if it's configure credentials. That's good. Connect. And boom, there's our data. Can double click or rename the table. It's customer, right? So we've got everything that's in here. We see all of our applied steps, and you'll see this query folding indicator over on the right-hand side. This can look a little confusing, and it honestly looks very scary right now. To me, it's showing that we don't query fold this item, but hover over the items. The thing that you want to see here is where it says this step will be evaluated by the data source. That means that this is folding actually back to the source, which is great. All of these you see where it's folding, and then you see this red item down on the inserted. And what it shows is this step will actually be evaluated by the data source. So that means we're actually folding, but what it's also saying is that the step is not supported by fast copy. And fast copy on the Dataflows Gen 2 side just means it's gonna pull data faster. So that could break the fold at that point. That's all this is telling you. So right now we're good, everything's folding and we're great. We're not gonna use fast copy, but that's okay. As long as I know that everything's coming in, we're good. And so you could go through here, make changes to fix folding as part of it. And then what I would do is just go back to advanced editor, copy this, put it back into Power BI Desktop, and your life is good. You've now validated it. Another item I want to call out here, if I right click on a given step, you'll see this view query plan. This is not available inside of Power BI Desktop yet. I hope it comes soon. But when you click this, as you're trying to figure out and diagnose like where query folding started or stopped, this is something that you can do. So if you ever see this, where you see basically two steps, you see the source and then you see the native query, life is good. If you see where this like branches out into streaming and then you got like all sorts of stuff here, that means query folding broke and it's doing everything on the Power Query side. Let me see if I can actually break query folding. There you go. So now we can see here that, hey, everything's being evaluated. And down here we'll see, oh, If we come down and then view query plan, now you'll see where we've got these multiple steps, right? It's not just the source and the value.native query. Now we've got other items in the list. So we know we broke query folding at this point. And you can kind of figure this out too. So add column and then it's doing date time. So now I know it's one of the dates. And so we've got to go through and do some things. The other thing you'll see is it's renaming columns after the fact too. So this is bad. And so here I'll just remove the step. And then here I would rather do it right on the column itself and then just say date, and then that will fold appropriately. Boom. The other thing you'll notice inside of Dataflows Gen 2 is you've also got Copilot. So you can do all these things if you've got the right capacity. So it can help you in this journey and make it faster. Now you've got a clean, repeatable pipeline. You're familiar with some of the steps. You're familiar with the flow. All you have to do is just hit refresh and it's amazing. Be sure to check out the playlist above my head to continue this journey inside of Power BI. As well as check out the QR code. So I've got some files there you can play around with. It's Excel and CSV, it's not SQL, but you can at least play around with some of the steps. Drop your comments and questions down in the comments below. And as always, thank you so much for watching. Keep being awesome, and we'll see you in the next video.